Hi, hello, welcome to Argument, a podcast staged to deliberate, discuss on the contemporary social, legal, and political issues. Today, we have with us Ritvik Guha Mustafi, a fourth-year law student in SLCU, and he's already graced us with his presence in the previous session. You can check that out as well on YouTube. The today's session, which we are dealing with, is on the Pegasus issue, where we'll be talking about how it was developed and how it gained attention in the international sphere, and how it finds its presence in India and the privacy issues that surround it as well.
This scandal rose to its very much prominence and how the opposition has tried to take up as a very important issue. But my very basic or primary question, how important is privacy? How important is privacy to a common citizen? And is it actually of great significance to take that issue forward, especially in a parliament as such? And also with regard to with the current context of the Pegasus scandal.
So when we looked at the importance of privacy, guys, so like, you know, after the digital revolution, which is already ongoing with new updates coming, you know, like on a monthly basis. So the digital revolution, all in all, has increased the usage of technology to collect, store, transfer data related to individuals, organizations, and sometimes with relation to the entire nation as well. Now, when we talk about privacy vis-a-vis the technological innovations and all, so privacy is a notorious concept, you know. So privacy, when we speak about privacy, there is no unanimous definition for privacy per se. So if we look at one of the earlier cases of United States, which dealt with the concept of privacy, Olmstead versus United States. So Thomas Cooley Justice opined that privacy basically would refer to the right to be left alone, and a unreasonable violation of such right would result in an intrusion into one's activity, which would be actionable under the law of torts or the constitutional law of that particular nation. Now, guys, I have a question to ask you. What do you think about the preamble of the Indian Constitution? I'll specify my question a bit. What is the nature of India as per the first line of the first two lines of the preamble of our constitution?
Sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic, and republic.
Right.
Those are the exact
words. Right. So when you speak about sovereign, socialist, secular, those are basically the aims of the nation state of India. When we speak about the nature, it's democratic republic. So when we speak about a democratic republic society, not just India, for that matter, all over the globe, wherever a state says that, okay, we are democratic republic, that in itself means that the basic human rights are inherent and natural. That is, they are not given. They already exist, however, under the umbrella of reasonable restrictions. So when we speak about, you know, privacy, or for that matter, the core concept of any human right, so it symbolizes a duty to respect any given individual's wishes and not to ignore it without any compelling reason, right? Now, when we speak about privacy, so privacy in India, if we see, in India, privacy was not the part of fundamental rights per se from the very beginning. It became a fundamental right comparatively recently in a 2017 judgment of Kuttaswamy. Now, however, if we look at the Indian cases, how it evolved, how it developed the concept of privacy, we can see that, you know, as and when the cases related to privacy and the breach thereof, you know, came before the Indian courts increasingly recognized the right to privacy as an essential part of a human right, a basic human right. I would speak about the treaty obligations of India and the judicial precedents, selected judicial precedents, and the evolution of privacy. But first of all, let's focus on the core issue of Pegasus vis-a-vis the right to privacy.
As you were highlighting on the concept of privacy, that gains the center attention because Pegasus as a software was developed with an intention to curb terrorism and criminal activities, right? But it ultimately, it did not fall into wrong hands as well, but it was used, as per the reports of Amnesty International and Forbidden Stories, it was used in a very wrong sense to intrude into the privacy of people. So this Pegasus actually in Greek mythology refers to, you know, a horse or a unicorn kind of an animal on which there's a person who rides. His name is Bellerophon. So here, this person, what he does is of most importance here because he holds a spear in his hand. So that is exactly what Pegasus tries to symbolize. That is spear phishing, which means through a zero installation policy, it spears into your personal data and information and it can be hacked. That is like if a person, like they can send this particular software from one country to another, and without you downloading it or installing it, just with a miscall, it can directly latch onto your phone and it can take out your data. So this Pegasus software as such was developed by a company named NSO. It's an Israeli company, and it goes by the names of its founders. So three of them: Neev Karmi, Omri Lavi, and Shalev Julio. So these people, again, they worked in Unit 8200 of Israel. Like, there are software experts, you know, trained by the government itself. And they came out of the government and they started this particular NSO corporation. The software itself gained its fame when the Mexican government had used this software. Like, it was used in a very primitive form to catch a very a notorious criminal called El Chapo. So that is where all the governments started noticing this particular software. Now, how was it that it came into allegedly into the hands of so many governments? And it is, we can say, used by governments because NSO itself...
It has clarified that it's only given to governments, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And though they're not revealing it, that who could be their potential, who were their customers, it could only be accessed by governments. And here again, I came across a source here wherein they were saying that it was actually sold by the Israeli government under the direction of their... previous president, I guess, Benjamin Netanyahu. So they say that there is an indirect link between all the countries that were using this software and the time frame in which their president had visited those particular countries. This came from a very prominent source wherein they said that when Netanyahu and Modi, when they were taking a walk on the beach, it became very, very famous, like when they had met together in a beach in Israel. They say that all the lists of people who had to be surveyed was set back then itself, right? And and they say that, you know, this timeline exactly matches when the governments had, you know, meetings or discussion, and that is how the software was sold. Now here, Israel also has a lot of duty in the international arena itself to make sure this software had to be monitored, because there's this thing called Wassenaar Agreement, which was signed in Hague. So even India is a party to this agreement, which says that, you know, these software, this is not just a simple software, but it's classified as a weapon, even as per the Israeli government, even as per the Wassenaar Agreement. So they have this thing called the End User Monitor Agreement, which casts a duty, obligation, or responsibility on not only the country which is using this software to spy on their citizens, but also on Israel, because this is not a very simple software. It's actually, it is a dangerous weapon that could be used as such. And the cost also, it's very expensive. They say that in India, around 300, based on this, reports were released by, you know, Forbidden Stories and Amnesty International. And they said that in India, around 300 contacts were being monitored. And it takes around $6 to $7 per year, million dollars per year to monitor just 50 contacts. And the list is among these 300 people, it includes judges, human rights activists, and not even the opposition, but even internally, whoever is a part of the current government was also being monitored, was allegedly being monitored. So,
but some might say it's just potential. It can be also potential targets, because it's not that all phones have been successfully infected, because you will be able to find one security forensic, if I'm not wrong, you'll be able to find traces of any kind of virus infected source as well. So that's one particular point which you actually pointed out.
One thing, the software was designed in such a way that in case affects any wrong mobile or device which it wasn't intended to do, it itself destructs itself within 7 days. No, but that's an anomaly that you can found even in the petitions also, that the Supreme Court has actually pointed it out that in all the people who filed petitions with regard to violation of right to privacy or whatever, none of them have submitted reports of their phones being infected. So you would require a forensic report. That's what the court also said, that you cannot base your petitions just on newspaper reports, right? Because they said even we are reading them. But the proper evidence would be submitting the phone to the forensic laboratories, which again has not been done.
Exactly. And when you look at the fact, so even if it is affecting a wrong device, which it was not originally intended to, still there is a reasonable apprehension that the software this much developed can still be a reasonably apprehended threat to privacy for even that not intended device. And in the sense ki injust, as the saying goes, injustice anywhere is the threat to justice everywhere. So the thing is ki even if some phones or some devices have not been infected, still the fact and the extent of the use from 2017-18 to 2021, now that it has become a full-blown scandal in Indian point of view as well, still now it's a really a type of topic which is pertinent for us to discuss. One question, when the NSO group propagated this particular software, or for that matter, any other government came up with propagation, any kind of propagation regarding this software, did they highlight the aims or objectives of this particular software anywhere?
The government, as in the Indian government?
No, not necessarily the Indian government. Any government or even the organization which actually made this particular software, did it anywhere highlight any core objective or anything, aims of this particular software?
So the organization's stance is that it was used, it should have been used to curb terrorism, right? And that is what the Wassenaar agreement mandates. Like, it's not only the governments which are using it, but also the Israel government should have monitored it to make sure it was being used for right purposes, mainly to curb terrorism, reduce crime. But that's not something that's happened here. And there were strict restrictions on importing these softwares. That again, there is this one more source which said, Israel had exported these softwares carelessly, if you can say, because again, Netanyahu's government was kind of dictatorial, and they wanted to maintain good relations with everyone else. And even from an economic standpoint, the software is very expensive. So it costs around like $6 to $7 million every year just to monitor 50 cell phones. So it's so they say, like, one was to improve relations with other countries, and other one was from economic standpoint of.
Sure. Yeah. And I mean, the basic underlying idea behind every technological innovation nowadays is to reduce the geographical gap between the nations. However, that does in itself pose a certain technological, administrative, constitutional risks. Now, when we focus about India, Article 51 in the Directive Principle of State Policy. Now, you already know that Directive Principle of State Policy actually provides a framework for the government to make its governance even more efficient, right? So now Article 51 verbatim says to foster respect for international law and treaty obligation in dealings of organized people with one another. Now, why am I citing this article right now? Now, it is to be noted here that India is a signatory and a party to major international conventions related to human rights, such as Universal Declaration of Human Rights or UDHR, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights or ICCPR, and International Covenant of Economic and Social Rights. Focusing on UDHR and ICCPR, Article 12 of UDHR and Article 17 of UDHR collectively mention a particular provision whose thematic overview, if we have to look, it is like, no one will be subjected to arbitrary interference with his privacy, family, home, or correspondence. If it is done, then it is a clear violation of law, and everyone has the right to be protected by the law against any such interference or attacks. Now, yeah, but by extension,
like, with regard to that, we do have there is, especially with regard to the Indian perspective, you have the Telegraph Act, wherein it mentions, according to Section 5, wherein it states that, you know, the power for the government to take possession of licensed telegraphs and in order to intercept, with regard to interception of messages, especially with regard to it being on interest of public safety and also if it's a public emergency, the state government or the central government may authorize on the behalf if it is satisfied and necessary to do so. And also, especially if it's with regard to the sovereignty of the country, and also with especially with regard to relations with foreign countries which have very friendly ties with India as well. So, what I'm able to draw is that, okay, fine, the Pegasus software can be considered as a foreign entity as such, but it's not like India has not already been privy to, you know, tappings and stuff. You had several governments also using it to tap on journalists or even to tap on leaders as well. Especially like talking about in my own state, you had a chief minister who literally resigned because of the allegations. His name was Ramakrishna Hegde, former CM. So you also had, you know, these kind of aspects. But so it brings a point, you know, like how tapping is different from a software, you know, which is so easy to just target any phone, even be it a more secured phone like an Apple, or the regular tapping tapping order which you get done legally as such. So how is that able to really how is there a difference between the two, or is it actually very similar? It's just that the source is very different as such.
Yeah, sure. I mean, with regards to the first point you raised broadly about the Telegraph Act and all, very valid point. I guess Section 5, Clause 2 of the Telegraph Act is the same. And also, if we look at the Information Technology Act, which we will be looking further in this discussion in a bit more detail.
Again, I think Telegraph Act also, like the same section mentions, you still cannot spy on journalists. Like you still can't,
yes.
You're not allowed to do that.
It's true that it's been arbitrarily used, but also you had a recent incident in Kashmir. You had this journalist with a grenade, if I'm not wrong. So you had possession of illegal weapons or goods. So I think, the arbitrary, it depends on how you define the law. The law is there, but depends on who's trying to enforce the law or trying to implement that particular law. If it's used for a bad or good thing, is depending on the government. Then as it is, it's available for the safety of the country is what one might gather from it. But
even if you look at the Telegraph Act, or even if you look at Section 69 of the Information Technology Act, which directs empowers the central or state government or any competent authority to monitor, intercept or decrypt any information transmitted, generated or received. So that underlying conditions are sovereignty, integrity, security of state, friendly relations with foreign state, public order, investigation of crime, etc., etc. So in a nutshell, when these provisions came, up, when these some of the Indian presidents we will see, the focus is basically on the maxim salus populi suprema lex est, that is the welfare of the society, and another thing, the rights of many override the rights of a few. However, so why did I state those things or those principles and maxims? Because so as to highlight the point that even though India is a under Article 51, it is, bound to follow or to implement the international provisions related to privacy or for that matter, any human right. None of those rights are, absolute in nature. Therefore, in Constitution, if you look at the language of the provisions, for example, let's take Article 14. The word used is shall, the constitution shall or the state shall. It is never will. So shall is a less, extreme version of will. And it says, it indicates that it is not an absolute thing. So now if we look at the evolution of privacy for that matter, if we look at two cases I'll take simultaneously, MP Sharma versus Satish Chandra and Khadak Singh versus state of Uttar Pradesh. So in these two cases, in the former, in the MP Sharma case, the Supreme Court of India straight away said that privacy is not protected or supported by the Indian Constitution. We cannot interpret privacy as an integral part of the Constitution. And in the Khadak Singh case, if we look at the majority opinion, restated what was stated in the MP Sharma case regarding the non-supportiveness of privacy as a concept within the constitution, and the minority judgment, the difference is the minority judgment in Khadak Singh, which stated, or which observed for that matter, that an individual's freedom from unreasonable encroachments or restrictions on his person is a major part of right to personal liberty under the fundamental right to life. So there the right to personal liberty as a concept was broadened. And in the Khadak Singh case, the foundation was laid down to increasingly interpret privacy as a major concept in the further cases. Now, if we look at the Govind Singh case, for that matter, Govind Singh case and also the PUCL versus Union of India. So PUCL directly deals with the telephone tapping, elements which you were mentioning, Joel. So therein, the court laid down various guidelines, five specific grounds, and also in the Govind Singh case, for that matter. So in those two cases, collectively, what did the Supreme Court hold? The Supreme Court did not say that right to privacy in itself is a separate fundamental right. However, privacy is an inviolable core for an individual's autonomy, and it exists within the penumbral regions of the fundamental rights. So you see how the concept of privacy evolved. And now we come to the heavyweight justice, retired Puttaswamy case, wherein it was the Aadhaar case, if you guys remember. Yes. And in that case, what was held? In that case, the court categorically overruled the MP Sharma and the Khadak Singh judgments insofar as they related to the right to privacy not being supported by constitution. And they straight away held that privacy anyways is an integral part of the Indian constitution. It is a part of the right to life. And you guys know that right to life under Article 21 is the article, or for that matter, the provision which has received the broadest possible interpretation in the Indian constitution till date, right? So the elements within the right to life and private personal liberty. And again, when the court said this, the right to privacy separately is a fundamental right still. And, to complement Joel's statement about telephone tapping and other conditionary, steps taken by any competent authority, the court straight away said that this, in any case, right to privacy, although now is a fundamental right or is to be treated as a fundamental right, it is not absolute. And the state and non-state actors can actually encroach upon the right to privacy. However, they have to satisfy the triple test of legitimate aim, proportionality, and the legality. So these are the triple test or the tripod stand on which a state actor or a competent non-state actor can encroach the privacy of individuals or organizations. Exactly.
Yeah, but because even in that other case, the private companies could not already access, like, because with regard to the KYC details and authentication of their of their aspect as well, it barred the private companies from making use of Aadhaar. But then, since you are basically giving in your details, be it a biometric data, be it details about the residence, it is still available for access for government agencies and also government entities to utilize it. So how does it go as an irony or an anomaly as to how government cannot utilize it for so-and-so activities as such?
Exactly. The same issue, what you said, the verbatim issue came in the case of United Identification Authority of India and another versus Union of India. So what does UIDAI do? It stores the biometric information, the biometric data in massive depositories. That biometric data includes the fingerprints, iris pattern, name, address, etc., etc. Now, what did Supreme Court say in that case? Supreme Court said or directed UIDAI not to disseminate any biometric information of any Aadhaar card holder without express and written permission of such holder or his duly authorized agent. Now, this is a direction of the Supreme Court. It gave an express direction regarding to the express issue that you just mentioned. However, yes, given the red tapism of Indian, bureaucracy, as well as, the overburdened kind of Indian judiciary, as well as the other organs of the government, and consequently the slow pace of actions means and, you know, provides an irony that there is a reasonable apprehension that such biometrics data can be misused. And for that reason, you know, for that reason, the debate that now, since the right to privacy is now a separate fundamental right, should we or should we not have a separate Right to Privacy Act, which states or mentions that, okay, this is privacy, this is this, this this is how it can be encroached, if at all, and this is how it can be penalized if it is encroached upon without any proper authority or proper reason. So the debate is still going on, and the same debate has resurfaced in this Pegasus tussle, right? So when we see about Pegasus and right to privacy in India vis-a-vis, so Naidali actually mentioned about what exactly the reports about Pegasus were. So the Pegasus project group, which included the Wire in India, the Guardian in UK, and the Washington Post in the US, suggested that journalists, cabinet ministers, and other important holders in administrative positions or constitutional positions were possibly subjected to surveillance. And now I will not go in detail about the nature of the Pegasus software, because it has been dealt comprehensively and beautifully by Naidali and complimented by you, Joel. So now when we speak about privacy, and given the fact that Pegasus is, you know, Pegasus software is a technological issue or technological innovation, so it's pertinent that we see some important provision of important provision of the Information Technology Act of India. So can you guys tell me
I just had one more doubt. All the judgments like that you mentioned, like except the Aadhaar one, like if you look into section 47 also of the, I think if I'm not wrong, the IT Act, like they only penalize corporations for taking away your data without your consent. But what about the government? Yes, the Puttasamy judgment dealt with it, but you also mentioned this criteria that if the privacy is being taken away, it should fulfill three tests. That is legality, proportionality, and what was the
legitimate aim.
Yeah. So here, for this thing to have been legal, even as per sections of IT Act, Telegraph Act, Section 5 of Telegraph Act should have been complied. Section 69 of the IT Act should have been complied. So that is something the government should clarify, that if these things have been because, okay, we understand privacy is not absolute in the country, but if was it legal? And even these sections, they mandate that you're allowed to do this only when there is, you know, for public safety, international relations, or some, when there is a discrepancy in the public order as such. That's not something that the public was aware of. Maybe there are other internal matters. But I came across one source which said that the government might have been aware in some manner or the other, because when the first time the media reports started surfacing about the Pegasus issue, the news became very famous around 18th July. And the government's response was dated 17th July, and it was not on any official paper as such, and there was no signature. But the words were correct. They've said that India is a robust democracy and government would not spy on its citizens. So that gives a very suspicious outlook, like from the government's part. Like, did you actually comply with the legal procedures before you did this? Or what was the public order that you wanted to protect before snooping on all these people? The current legal framework that we have and the sections that need to be complied is Section 5 of the Telegraph Act and 69 of the IT Act. So if government was really doing something legal, which they have responded even in the monsoon session in the parliament, as well as one of their arguments during the Supreme Court's the petitions hearing, they said that nothing was done unlawfully. So they must have obviously complied with these two provisions. And even these two provisions mention that there should be a threat to a public order or something like to maintain friendly international relations. Now, there was no threat to public order as such in India is what I perceive. But another thing is, we don't know about international relations, but because it's obviously like kept very confidential. But why spy on your own cabinet ministers and journalists? We understand if you spy like on terrorists and all, but some of the alleged names that have appeared, it also includes the Delhi commissioner, who himself is empowered under the IT Act. I think they released a notification back in December 2018 that actually allows 10 agencies to have access to software like Pegasus. so that they, it can be used for investigative purposes. But you use it to spy on a Delhi commissioner's phone. Like that was one of the names that surfaced. So that seems very absurd. Like why, in what sense it was being used?
Coming to that commissioner, because I think what the common belief is that people must, like, it must have been used during that particular incident of the CBI incident, wherein there was a huge tussle inside the CBI against Rakesh Astana and who was the other one, like there were between the CBI directors, and that's how it was. It's a very controversial role which he's playing right now, because he's currently the Delhi commissioner. As per the court order, some might say it goes against the court, the Supreme Court order.
That's what, which one of those 10 authorities were authorized to use this software? So that 10 of them, it includes ED also, it includes CBI and all these people and other intelligence agencies. So which one of them was using them? And like you, and they were spying even on like the own like people, like, and own cabinet ministers also. That makes it like very makes it very curious for me.
Yeah, I mean, basically, it's the, you know, the core question which always comes up with regards to technology or science for that matter. Is it a boon or a bane? It depends on how you use it, right? So answering, you know, your question about legality, not answering per se, just complimenting your views on that. So when you say about spyware related activities as a whole, not just Pegasus, any kind of spyware related activities, it is based on gaining access, and most of the times it is unauthorized access to computer systems or communication devices without the permission of the actual owner. And if done without express authority by the government, under Indian surveillance law regime, such an act is presumably dishonest and fraudulent. Now, speaking about, you know, the legality as well as the IT Act provisions, I'll also club one of my recommendations herein because the context has built up like that. So when we talk about IT Act and the express provisions under it, so Section 72, Sections 43A, Sections 69, so all of them data and saving it from encroachment, until and unless it is done with authorized access and certain given conditions, right? So one of the recommendations can be to resolve this. And however, you know, with regards to government's answers in the monsoon session, or for that matter, in front of the Supreme Court, they are still, you know, debatable, because had it not been debatable, there wouldn't have been so much unrest and ruckus in the monsoon session between the government and the opposition. And the recommendations would have been clear to the light. However, now the fact is that since I already mentioned earlier, the debate of having a separate, you know, privacy act has resurfaced. But let's face it, the procedure of passing an act, that too in the Indian regime, Indian legislative regime, it's a really lengthy procedure, right? So you guys will definitely read about the exact articles in your upcoming semesters. You'll definitely read it. So the procedure is really lengthy. It may take time, and it will take time for that matter. But we need a bit of quick solutions, right? We need solutions for at least the foreseeable future. How do we do it? So we have to do it with the existing regime only. Now, how do we do it with the existing regime? So if we look at Section 43A of the IT Act, it includes the body corporate and, you know, elements about sensitive data, etc. So now it can be done. It is recommended, or it is suggested, that an amendment can be brought about. An amendment can be brought about in that particular provision, wherein the terms body corporate and the elements therein, and sensitive data and the elements therein, can be increased in their respective ambits. Because right now they are a bit narrow, they are a bit more specific towards companies per se, and sensitive data does not include many important things. So if we increase the ambit, amend that specific provision, at least for the temporary basis, we can have a good foundation in it. And then if we can draw parallels, because you know, looking at the Indian Constitution. Indian Constitution loves to, you know, adopt some things from other jurisdictions as well. You guys have definitely read this about the Indian Constitution, right? It has taken so many provisions from so many different jurisdictions. So in the same manner, if we look at the United States regime, surveillance regime, or for that matter, United Kingdom, now we see there that whenever they talk about surveillance, they always specify the data retention period, the exact amount or the exact part of conversations to be recorded. They always specify that in their legislations and, you know, in their
Think in 2012, the AP Shah committee reports, they have adopted all these things. I think they've given the 9 principles, consent and whatever you said, like the data retention as to what time it can be retained for and to what purposes it's being used for. I think they could certainly take hints from that committee, because it not only, like, my opinion is not only about these data, like something you get from a computer, like even the biometric information, whether it's obtained from an electronic device, or I was working on this aspect of forensic sciences as well. Even that is also a kind of data, right? It's your, again, a personal data. And see, once the court takes that, like the data from you, like through forensic sciences, and you never know what happens to it later. Like, and you have, and one more thing, the committee also said that you should have a bureau itself, or you should have some adjudicating authority to look into these particular cases. Like, and they also said you should have an option to appeal as well. Because this being a fundamental part of your privacy, I think even the existing provisions, if you're looking, and even the Telegraph Act, it talks about just phone tapping. And that is just long gone. We don't use those kind of phones anymore. So I think, like, despite making changes in the current regime, but since that, as you said, legislation will take a lot of time, they could certainly start looking into it. The Pegasus was a good thing to, like, you know, formulate a data protection bill as such, not only with respect to the electronic data obtained, even to forensic sciences, because that was one of the recommendations of the AP Shah committee reports.
Exactly. Adding
on to that, I think all of you all must be also aware about the Neera Radia tapes as well, right? If you remember in the previous regime, there were several journalists and also basically Neera Radia is actually this person who was involved in the especially with regard to Tata's and handling their company with regard to PR and everything. So she kind of, like, I don't know, it's like setting up your own cabinet in the government. So she was able to contact, you know, journalists like allegedly Barkha Dutt or even Veer Sanghvi and other journalists as well. And then the call recordings of those calls came public. So while we think about an aspect of bringing in the data protection, also considering the fact that a journalist and fellow opposition leaders might fall prey to, you know, privacy invasions by the government or so, but also we might tend to neglect the aspect of how, you know, companies can be fixed. Like, example, even private organizations can also, like, okay, man, the NSO is claiming that they only give it to governments with regard to their software. How are we so assured that private organizations or private companies might not be using the software in order to get more information about that? Because that particular instance of this of these tapes became a very highlight aspect. That's why many of the times people don't like these journalists as well, and also those ministers of the particular regime as well. So how do you, like, though we went through the Shah committee as well, how do you bring the aspect of how we balance the two aspects, bringing out an act and also bringing out you know, it being very essential in the same hand? Because over there also, it's not known who leaked the source, like who leaked the calls or who leaked the recordings, but it was still accessible to public domain as such. So how are we going to move forward with regard to making it more accessible? Should it be accessible to the public, or should there be, like what you mentioned, the data protection bill, which can cover these aspects as well?
No, I think certainly when,
go on.
No, I think when it comes to data, like your biometric information or the forensic science data that is being collected from you, you certainly need to have a privacy a bill, sorry, an act, because that is something very personal to you. And I don't think so anyone should be able to derive an economic benefit from it. For example, your thumbprint, if someone takes it away, your property can be snatched. Again, you have your right to property as well as per 300, Article 300 of the Constitution. So that is something that shouldn't be used by the corporation, something that only the law enforcement agency should have access to. And again, make up steps so that they also don't misuse it. But other things, like as you said, like leaking of call records and all these things, again, another aspect comes in there. So what if those things are for public good? What if those calls need to be actually leaked for public good?
Yeah.
All right. Regarding, Joel, your question about the way forward and about how, you know, whether or not it is used for public good and all, it depends actually, you know. So the government, as Nidalee had already mentioned, the government in its previous statements has claimed that, okay, it has not used it illegally or for any unreasonable, you know, in any unreasonable manner or for any unreasonable objective. However, in order to make that claim valid, the government may, on its own accord, carry out some structured investigations so as to see or to reveal any mischief or fraud carried out by any government authority or any private entity concerning, you know, vis-a-vis this Pegasus scandal. Now, whatever you do, in any case, see, the objective behind using the spyware should be that of public good, because ultimately what you are doing while spying, you are encroaching upon a given individual's privacy, right? So in a sense, you are breaking that fundamental right. Now for that, you have to have those three, you know, triple test. You have to conform to the triple test of Puttaswamy. And in basic sense, you have to have a very good reason for doing it. And that good reason must conform to the public good. Now, the fact is that whatever needs to be done, be it, formulating another act, be it amending the current legal regime, be it taking the recommendations of the applying it or implementing it in the form of guidelines, or for that matter, you know, carrying out investigations and stuff, whatever needs to be done has to be practical, realistic, and economically feasible. The same thing applies to every statutory, you know, actions of the government. And at the end of the day, what is the underlying, you know, concern or underlying foundation? That any such remedifying actions or corrective actions should ideally conform with the democratic nations of freedom, dignity, truth, and the broader concept of human rights. So that is specifically the way forward. In my recommendations, I gave in a nutshell how to amend the current statutory regime, and Nidalee, chipped in with her recommendations about the Shah committee's recommendations and implementations thereof. So those are a few recommendations, and the structured investigations as well. So those are the few steps that the government can take practically, feasibly, and realistically so as to, you know, resolve this ongoing matter. So yeah.
All right. So I think with that being said, let's take in some final words with regard to how this scandal can pose to be of greater harm or threat. And coming back to my first question, okay, how important it is to the common citizen is what one might also tend to ask, because the software is predominantly used on famous, on eminent personalities, journalists, politicians, and not on the common person as such. So how far it is a election issue or how far it is of a political importance is also one might state, because though the opposition was initially on strong arms against the Pegasus scandal, but now it's moved towards more grassroots level issues like the farm laws and things like that. So again, the aspect of, I think the one recommendation what one might want to really bring about is like, we need to be taught what exactly is privacy and what is like education about how, like digital education is something which needs to go on forward with regard to the current generation, because it's okay of you handling the your smart device and everything, but then everything needs to be taken with due care and also whatever you do. So I think with regard to imparting digital education and awareness, and also with regard to aspects teaching about aspects about these privacy related issues and everything, be it in law school or be it even in regular courses as well, is that something which should really start from the current level? Because right now, maybe the past two centuries, it was always a war on weapons, but now the war is on technology, and war is mainly on tech-related issues by several countries, including China and many other aspects as well. So I think with that being said, if you have any other further points with regard to this session, or we could draw it to the close as such.
Yeah, I mean, finally, the point you raised about education. So, you know, personally, I am a humanities student. I was a humanities student in plus two. So, yeah, I read political science. Yeah, political science in detail in plus two. However, the basic concepts of fundamental rights, constitutionality and all are being taught to us from, you know, standard 8th or 9th onwards. So now the curriculum needs to be updated properly and reasonably vis-a-vis the, you know, current developments. So as you said, the privacy education about privacy. So, you know, the course of privacy, the core concept of privacy, the guidelines related to it, they can be incorporated in curriculum in easy to understand language for in both, you know, in regional languages as well as in English. So that curriculum change can be done. Regarding election issue, Pegasus being an election issue. See, what happens in marketing? So basically what happens in marketing or advertisement is that if a brand is endorsed by a well-known personality, the common folks are, you know, drawn towards that brand, or their curiosity is at least aroused. Okay, we got to check this brand. What is it? Because this famous person is endorsing it. Given the fact that Pegasus has mostly spied upon on eminent personalities, you know, having, you know, good stand in the society, a much more respectable stand. Now that can, you know, affect the mentality of the common folk as well. Ki, you know, the saying goes in Hindi, inke saath ho sakta hai, toh humare saath bhi ho sakta hai. If they can face it, if such eminent personalities can face it, then who are we? We are normal, common man, common folk. So that way their mind can be formulated. The opposition can use this issue with how they always use the important issues. The opposition can use this issue in the next elections or by-elections by saying, ki, okay, the BJP government or the ruling party does not give enough, you know, importance to the fundamental rights of the citizens. It carries on its whims and fancies and so on and so forth. And the BJP government can again counter it by, you know, giving all the arguments that it has already been giving and updating it further as and when required. So in that sense, it can be an important election issue, just like demonetization, Article 370, abrogation, the Ram Mandir issue and all that. So yeah, but in any case, whatever the governments do, they just have to conform to the fundamental notions of human rights, dignity, truth, and freedom. So yeah, that's it from my side.
Adding on to what both of you said, our human rights should not become a tool for any political parties to advance their interests or come to power. Because an issue about violation of human rights should not gain importance just because one government wants to use it against others. So what if you weren't caught? Like, what if nobody knew Pegasus was being used? The continuation of violation of right to privacy would have been prolonged. And in Israel also, there would have been, one of the sources said, if it was Netanyahu's government as such, they would have tried their level best to suppress these things. But it was allowed to come into light, and the government is probing on this because the current government, the president has changed. So they want to highlight what kind of a dictatorial kind of a government did Netanyahu have. So that's the reason that they're probing into this issue. France is probing into this Pegasus issue again because Morocco, the country has used it on the president's phone itself. Macron's phone was hacked. And here again, we see in West Bengal, a probe was again ordered by Mamata Banerjee's government. So stop advancing your political ideologies or your political goals in the pretext of safeguarding our human rights. And again, what would happen is, like, when you set up these kind of probes, like, if you see these technology and all these, like, defense affairs come under the union list, and they will again counter it by saying it is stateless, that will again invalidate whatever the findings of the probe is. I really wish if the central government took this issue seriously, like, you know, with regard to safeguarding the human rights, kindly order a probe or an inquiry into this to actually know. Because even the petitions, what was very sad to see is that don't base anything just on newspaper reports. What would make it more admissible is you surrendering your phones to forensic, like the department. So why wasn't that done? Again, that is again a gray area. Why wouldn't the petitioners do it? And even when Amnesty International and all these people were gathering the report, not many journalists agreed for their phones to be submitted. So yeah, I think it would be good, like, if the international committee itself, you know, ordered a probe into this, and the government of India as well, just to, like, you know, ensure that the people's confidence it stays with the government, and not, and our human rights violation should not be taken to, you know, advance political agendas, like, as per time. Because after this, again, the Afghanistan, the Taliban issue has taken center place. So it wasn't, it's not as debated as it was, like, back then. So, yeah.
We would like to thank Hrithik once again for coming over to this session. Though we have a few glitches as well with regard to the team, but surely we'll be joining back in the next episode with our full team as well. And stay tuned till our next episode. You'll be able to find this current episode on YouTube, on Spotify, on IGTV and other platforms as well. And also do comment as to how you find the significance of what, how important is privacy to you, and also how audacious is this mechanism of spying as well. And we would love to hear your feedback also with regard to the video as well. So until then, thank you so much for staying tuned, and good night.